Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Peter Seddon from Democratic Services, Liverpool City Council. As we received apologies quite late from the Chair, Councillor Roz Gladden, I need a nomination for the Chair for this meeting, please. Thank you. Any other nominations?
Yes.
Therefore, Mike Cairns will be Chair for this meeting. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, colleagues. If I can open the meeting. Can I welcome everyone to the meeting with the Joint Health Scrutiny Committee and invite attendees to introduce themselves. My name is Mike Cairns. I'm a councillor in Knowsley, Borough Council Scrutiny Committee to Health and Social Services. Thanks very much for that, colleagues. Can I advise that the apologies for absence have been received for Councillor Eddie from Lancashire, Councillor Linoke from Knowsley, and Councillor Cllr from Sefton. Are there any further notifications and apologies?
Councillor Roz Gladden has previously. Chair, can I just refer to the member of the opposition?
Our colleague on the internet. Introduce yourself, please. Well done. We still can't hear you. Can you turn the mic on?
Hi, I'm Barry Dog. I'm a stroke consultant, South Board of Chair, Gary Jones.
Lovely, thank you. Can you see everybody else in the chamber? No. Okay, we'll continue. Can I invite any declarations of interest? Respective items on this agenda? None received. Thank you. Can I refer the Joint Committee members to pages 1-8 of the agenda of the minutes of the last meeting, which took place on the 11th of May 2022? Do any members who were present have any accuracy issues or matters arising? None received. I move that the minutes be approved as a true and accurate record of the meeting. Is this agreed? Is that unanimous? Yes, thank you. Members will be aware each of the four local authorities represented here today received a case for change through their local authority scrutiny arrangements and determined that the proposals represented a substantial variation of service. As such, we formed this joint committee to undertake undertake an in-depth scrutiny of the proposal through receiving reports over a number of meetings. Can I invite Carol Hill to present the final report, which includes feedback to the public consultation?
Thank you, Chair. So this is the latest presentation from the NHS around the proposal for a new hyper-acute stroke service for the population of Liverpool, Knowsley, Sefton and West Lancashire. I am conscious that there's probably at least one councillor perhaps who is a new member to this committee. So the paper does recap on the proposal, the case for change, why we want to establish this service, what the clinical model is, and the substantial variation itself, which is that we would establish a hyper-acute stroke service on one site, which is the entry site provided by Liverpool University Hospitals, and involving services from Southport and Ormskirk Trust, and also the Royal Hospital, which is part of Liverpool University Hospitals. So this paper sets out the overview of the proposal. It sets out the process that we've undertaken in line with the statutory requirements that are on us, best practice requirements, and the role of scrutiny for our population. It sets out in summary the findings of the consultation. There is a separate document which is in the pack, the consultation report. And for those who've been on this journey with us, we have actually presented the detail already on the public consultation at previous meeting. The other thing that I want to say is that following the consultation, the purpose of the consultation, of course, is to receive views from patients, public and stakeholders, but it's also about being clear that we have taken on board the issues that have been raised and considered those. So this paper also provides an overview of the key themes and the actions that have been taken or will be taken from that process, and they relate to access, NWAS response. We also taken on board the issues raised by the committee around outcomes, and I think as well there's been discussion and scrutiny around NWAS capacity and response times. Finance as well has been an area that you requested further information on, hence why we've got a broad representation today so that we can answer any further questions that you have. The following the consultation, that informed a final business case, which has now been approved by the trust boards involved, also by the boards of Cheshire and Merseyside, the Integrated Care Board, and Lancashire and South Cumbria as well, because of the West Lancs population being affected by this. So that was really what I wanted to say as an overview. I think this is an opportunity now for us to answer any further questions, address any concerns. If the scrutiny committee is satisfied in terms of the recommendations that have been set out, the next stage in the process would be to actually mobilise the service, and there are plans. There are plans that process would commence later on in September with the first phase of the change, which is bringing together a single service on the entry site. The second phase
trust here. At RMS, there was concern raised, and I noticed in the consultation to the executive about the problem for Southport residents with accessibility. Because the ambulance gentleman has been very open and helpful to me earlier today when we were having a little tete-a-tete about it. I can see entirely that if I was living in Bootle, in Crosby, in McGarnell, I'd be chuffed. I can see very much if I lived in most of the student region, it would cause me a moment's concern. But for those of us who represent folk who live in the PR8, PR9 postcodes, there are concerns. There are concerns, one is a broader concern that another service leaves Southport Hospital and therefore becomes less viable as a general hospital. But specifically on strokes, the point that's been put to me by residents is simply this. If I lived, for example, in Crossings in Southport, in the north of Southport, I spoke to an elderly lady this morning who was concerned. Her reaction was if she or her partner had a stroke, she would present at Southport Hospital A&E. And that's what most people will do. They will not have read this document. They will not know they ought to go somewhere else. They will go to A&E or they will frankly present there themselves by their own transport. This woman was going to take a taxi. She thought it's the quickest way of getting from Crossings to. So we've got a problem where she's going to take, you know, half an hour or more to get from Crossings to, you know, the time she's got a taxi, she's lucky, into A&E. She's then got to get into A&E and be assessed. And then, taking the worst case scenario, she's got to be transferred to Aintree. Well, I've been reading the NHS Federation report on transfer times, and I've been watching the performance, which is not any reflection at all on the ambulance service who come into the job with the tools they've been given. But if you look at the times, that would begin to create anxiety in the with most people who would think, I've got to get there quickly, this is a matter of urgency, and we're building the delays. I'm also fascinated by the thought of a 44-minute transfer from PR9 to Aintree. Man thinks with his blue lights he'll make it, but I have to say that I've never had blue lights, but I've never made it in anything like that time. And I wouldn't be travelling at Friday at 4 o'clock and switch on and be packed up and I've got to get through into one of the woods when someone's broken down. So you need to reassure me, because frankly I'm not reassured. I see the reports being written, I can see you all gung-ho for the solution, and it's like many officers' reports, you see four options and you know there's only one they're contemplating, but it's a real concern that for Southport and for the north of Southport in particular, these timescales look conservative. So my question is, what legacy service is left in Southport? What telemedicine option, what new digital innovation would be available? So that if things do go, what is the polite phrase, belly up, what do we do? Because frankly, the transfer time's getting more. The distance from the lady's house to hospital, assessment, transfer, injury, we're getting to silly times.
There is a number of questions in there. Do you need to bring any of your colleagues in to answer part of it? Yeah.
Can you hear me now? So I think there are different components to that. I think one is around some of the assumptions that you may have made around how people access, how people travel to hospital and how many use ambulance or drive, which we can look at. But I think the key thing is to bring in Paddy McDonald, who's the stroke consultant from Southport, and my other clinical colleagues, around reassurance about the outcomes from doing this in terms of the trade-off between travel and So Paddy can talk about what is available, what the service will be in terms of the legacy. Maybe if John could talk about travel times, and then the commissioners talk about the model generally. I think if we start with Paddy.
Right, having yours to do brain scanning and so on. technology and available treatments, which is going to be ongoing, which is also important about future-proofing the service. And when I think people are being asked in public consultation, most people want the best care available, and that may not always be at a local hospital. But what you have to remember with stroke is time is brain, and also enabling people to get from Bexley will actually reduce in time if we do use this service.
So from an MS point of view, I think there are two aspects to our role here. You talk about direct conveyance from C, that's where a patient will ring 999 and will attend the home address, essentially take them directly to H. That cuts out the time spent in Southport BD in case they need specialist transfer. In terms of the infertility transfer question we talked about, where a patient would lock up to Southport BD and then need transfer to H, there's two aspects to that. One is getting the ambulance to Southport to the ED. And it's not surprising to say that ambulance times are slightly pressured and well publicised at the moment. There's a lot of work going on with the system to reduce hospital delays and other factors which affect our ability to respond. In terms of transfer from Southport to Aintree, I work operating on ambulances obviously, and with the assistance of blue lights, the traffic and congestion becomes less of a problem, and you can zip through the major junctions and the major roads fairly quick. I've also spent some time working on the helicopter emergency medical service. Across the Northwest, and transfers from Barrow to Blackpool for cardiac problems, and from across Morecambe Bay and across those big expanses of area, are routinely undertaken by helicopters. So where there are delays to road vehicles being able to make that transfer, we do have the facility to call on Northwest Air Ambulance and undertake that transfer, and that has no such road issues.
Sorry, does that bring anything
like private capital? As part of our provision to the population of Northwest, Northwest Ambulance Service works collaboratively with Northwest Air Ambulance, or the HeliMed team, or the HEMS team, and they provide a direct response to scene for us, so we provide doctors and critical care paramedics to see, but they also undertake transfers on our behalf as well across long distances or where there's complicating factors.
Looking at the pathway for that patient you described, that lady you described, in the old system and the new system. So, imagining this lady had worst case scenario stroke, a large stroke, a big blood clot blocked off a major artery in the brain. Under the old system, she would go to Southport Hospital, under the current system, hopefully Paddy's in that day, but Paddy may be on annual leave, because unfortunately occasionally he's allowed time off, or it may be a weekend, but hopefully Paddy's there and sees the patient. If not, that patient is still seen by somebody who's technically capable but isn't necessarily a stroke consultant, but maybe seen through telemedicine to support them. That patient would be assessed and would be given thrombolysis, a clot-busting drug, assuming a CT scan and their angiogram confirmed the large vessel blood clot. They would then be we'd then call the Walton Centre, they'd look at the scans, and then we'd transfer the patient to the Walton Centre. But at that point, they may be waiting for another ambulance, which may be another longer delay than we'd like, before then they're taken from Southport to the Walton Centre for their thrombectomy, the treatment to remove that clot. The net effect of that is a delay to getting that key treatment that's going to remove the clot. Under the new service, this patient almost certainly would be in ambulance because it's a big stroke. She's not going to be in a position to get into a car or ask for help, unless her husband bundles into a car, but they'd be quite disabled, it would be difficult. So almost certainly would be coming in an ambulance, and the ambulance would know to go directly to
it's the self-present. I would say this is the lady who's thinking about the husband, not her, but there we go. I think that it's the self-presenting concern there.
And for those self-presenting patients, the majority of them aren't going to be the ones who need thrombectomy, because that's a big stroke, but they would essentially still follow the same pathway. When they get to Southport, if treatment needs to start in Southport, it can. And Southport colleagues can contact us, or whoever's on Aintree, to make an assessment through telemedicine, just like it would be if Paddy's at home on the weekend, and make that decision to start treatment there and then, whilst waiting for the ambulance. And as soon as the ambulance arrives, we'll stop what we're doing, get them over to Aintree, carry on what we're doing, and get them to the next appropriate place. The benefit at Aintree as well is that the separate front door means we'll be absolutely geared up for these patients the moment they come in. You won't be going through an A&E, which unfortunately like ambulance services have their own delays at the moment, but they're coming straight to us with our own CT scan. Really, that's phase two, so it's a few months from now, but our own CT scan to make sure they get the care immediately. And we have considered patients like the lady you described throughout this, but we genuinely, as clinicians, believe this is going to improve care for those patients as well as for everybody else in Cheshire and Mersey, or at least in North Mersey.
Is that in response to that?
Because we've also been to Lancashire and South Cumbria ICB, we did look at the patient data around Southport, and by memory, 76% of patients who arrive at Southport at the moment do so by ambulance. So the vast majority of them are not self-presenting. In terms of
high
sorry?
25% depth.
Yes, yeah.
Thank you, Chairman. This is our fourth meeting, and we have discussed these issues at length. And I'm absolutely convinced that the clinical part can involve a change. Myself and Councillor Pope in West Lancashire. And I represent the Tarleton Investment Bank banks, which is the other side of Southport. We did have concerns about travelling times. But we had a detailed report, and there's an extra vehicle going on to the front. And there's an opportunity to mention in the report about viewing what's achieved in the future. Be interested in that, perhaps not a reconvene, but just an update on information after the first 12 months, this sort of thing. The case is compelling. I've personally experienced, I live in hospital, which is next to Southport, and I had a cardiac arrest 3 years ago. I had a helicopter on my drive, didn't get to go with it, but they took me by ambulance, rickety ambulance, all the way to Broad Green. And literally in the back door, a stent in, an amazing treatment, but that's a centre of excellence, and this could be the same thing. I had a lot of experience with Aintree in the Walton Centre. My daughter had a brain injury, so it's been 6 months now. That's a real centre of excellence as well.
Thank you for that.
So I would urge us to support the recommendation.
Chair, can I just come back on that point about transfer time in terms of the stroke as an area of medicine. So this isn't the first time we've seen centralisation services to improve better outcomes. And my experience the first time was with a procedure called PCR or angioplasty for heart attacks. And Liverpool Heart Chest is the centre for Cheshire and Merseyside in terms of heart attacks, as you know, as well. So if you have a heart attack in Warrington or even further down into Cheshire, or Chester, or Southport. You're currently going to Liverpool Heart and Chest if you meet the criteria. A couple of years ago, we introduced a separate pathway for major trauma, and if you come off your bike in one of those areas, at speed, you'll be taken to Aintree Major Trauma Centre, and you'll bypass a number of EDs on the road. Because it's recognised that those centres give better care when it's intensive to a specific issue. It's not the first time we've done it.
Yes.
Okay. note that once this change has happened, it's, we don't walk away, and we are committed to measuring the impact, the outcomes of this. So there is a section in the paper that, you know, we've identified the key outcomes that we would want to track and measure as we go forward. And also there is a commitment to work with, on an ongoing basis with the ambulance service to make sure that we get that right as well. So that is really, you know, our commitment. Should we go ahead, we will go ahead with this, with this this change. So like major trauma that John mentioned, you know, there will be an ongoing assessment of the benefits and the outcomes that we would expect to see from this, and they will be held accountable for that.
Yes. Can I ask a few questions then? A couple. We've always been concerned about that 4-hour window and how that 4-hour window works. I'm in favour of this new system that's going to be built into the entry, the Stoke unit itself, so that because you've got all the technology that's required to save people's lives within that sort of window. In the interim, between September, when this goes through, to the building and opening of that, is this still sort of units like support, like where I live up in Knowsley, Liverpool Teaching Hospital, are there still units going to be working there? Because there is a heart. Every one of them has got a coronary post in that area. Is that going to be still in place for the interim period before we sort of amalgamate everything into that one unit? Because it looks as though we're taking all the expertise and plonking it in the middle of the entry. The second question I've got is, possibly you might be able to answer this one, as well as yourself, is that because it's one of the sort of illnesses that have a window, and I'm always on about this window, have we got, when you phone 999, a dedication line from them to be able to advise people who are reporting a possible stroke, possible, because everybody watches the television and the indications are, you know, the face and all the thing that go with it. Is there some line that people can actually be passed on to get advice while we're waiting for the ambulance? And can we be assured that the ambulance, I mean, I know you go through the blue light system and everything, but the public need to know, and the public do need to know, is that the service is going to be upgraded. Your people don't need the pressures that they're under at the moment. That pressure needs to be taken away from them so they can react, and there's space to react. Well, thank you.
I'll answer the what are we doing from September, and then I'll hand over to John, who can just talk about the dedicated stroke NWAS pathway. So you are right. The new front door stroke assessment centre is due to open in spring next year, where we'll have our own sort of, if you like, stroke emergency department. But from September, we will still implement the change. So what we will have on the entry site is that we will have dedicated specialist nurses around the clock in the emergency department. We will have a dedicated consultant on site till 8 p.m. who's purely there for the assessment of stroke within the emergency department, supported by a team of doctors, junior doctors, nurses, other specialists. We're opening a 19-bedded hyper-acute stroke unit. The current location will be next door to our step-down unit entry. However, in the future, it will be co-located at the front door alongside the assessment unit. For post-72-hours care, there's a step-down unit at entry. There will be the 20-bedded stroke unit at South Port for post-72-hour care and rehabilitation. And then there'll be rehabilitation at Brodie-Brown, and then all of the community obviously the initial interim period is going to be a little bit challenging while the A&E departments at Southport and Royal get used to changes. So as Paddy outlined before, there will still be a strong stroke nurse presence both on the Royal site and on Southport site, and they will have access to the team based at Aintree. So you've got around the clock stroke consultant who is on call, who can take calls from the sites at Southport, at Broadgreen if needed, at the Royal, and we've got the ability to communicate via telemedicine. So we can see the patient, we can speak to the patient, we can actually get their brain scans sent to our telephone so we can view them straight away. And then obviously there will be a dedicated MWAS pathway. We are also looking at other pathways where we can, not immediately, because there's too much, we don't want too much change at once, but they're starting a pilot across the Northwest, but looking at telemedicine use with our MWAS colleagues as well. So we'll be looking at trying to implement that very soon. So the types of things that might be useful for advising on sort of immediate management, but also if we've got a patient who the paramedic is not quite sure whether or not a stroke, we potentially could assess them there at home or within the ambulance to say, no, this definitely isn't, don't bother bringing to Aintree, actually you're close to Southport, take this older frail patient to Southport or whatever. So that will really help as well. In terms of sort of direct advice for patients, obviously the advice for anyone who's got stroke symptoms is always going to be ring 999 and get yourself to hospital. But there are already sort of helplines and stuff in place within our current units where our stroke patients can access advice via stroke nurse. But I mean, I'll hand over to John just so we can explain the new pathway.
So chronologically it might be helpful if I just explain to you what happens when somebody rings 999 and a call comes into the ambulance service. So we've moved to a telephone triage system called NHS Pathways, which is in use across 111, and it's the same system a lot of ambulance services now use to triage 999 calls, and asks quite a lot of detailed questions as a caller. So prior to the pathways being introduced, the time you're on the phone to the call taker was quite short whilst an ambulance was being dispatched, so we could only gather limited information. NHS Pathways causes longer call duration times, but we get much more valuable, rich information from the callers, and that enables us to make a better informed decision about the triage category that the patient goes into. So we operate along the ambulance response performance criteria. There are four categories to that. So to very, very briefly, category one would be your immediately life-threatening conditions where you get that in a 7-8 minute response. Category two is for acutely unwell, and category three and category four are patients who call us, but their care might be dealt with by an appropriate community provider or even self-care. So strokes generally fall into the category two response category, alongside a lot of other acutely unwell patients. So road accidents could fall into there, chest pain could fall into there, people who've been on the floor for a long time after a fall would fall into potentially category two. So to try and determine and elicit the more serious conditions, the more serious calls within category two, we have a team of clinicians who review that queue of incidents and try and identify the ones that require further interrogation or further information. And we'll call the caller back and try and answer some more questions over telephone triage. So telephone triage is really limited. If I ask you now, if I sort of ask you how pale are you, it's quite easy in the room to tell, but over the telephone it's really difficult. So we do come to a point where we can only ask so many questions and then we need a face-to-face assessment. And it's trying to determine those cases where we do need that sort of further information or we need the urgent face-to-face assessment. Does that answer your question? Depending on presenting the vision, I said that category two covers a range of calls. have chest pain, you will expect a call from one of our clinicians to just try and find out more information, and they'll give you advice in the interim.
The next question, anyone else know? My question is, have we got the staffing levels to support this, and are we recruiting from the universities to ensure that we will end up with the staffing levels?
Well, I can start by telling you about consultant staffing, so our senior doctor staffing. If we carried on trying to run three separate stroke units, we very much would be struggling to maintain that. We do have the staffing levels to run a service we're aspiring to, which, I apologise, does involve three separate stroke units, but one hyper-acute centre with the other units being for step-down care. We have a full rota which is already written up for the next 12 weeks with names in every slot on that rota. And I think the fact that this service will be, I like to think, should be amongst the very best in the country, if not Europe, when it's completed, and we'll be delivering the best possible care, means people are interested in joining our service. I think virtually all the junior doctors in the region who are doing stroke want to come and be part of this service when they qualify, which two such one will qualify in the next year, and then there's a few in a year or two afterwards. So we're looking very strong. We have been recruiting, and we have recruited more in the last few weeks to support that. Nursing and therapy staffing is also looking strong. It's taken a lot of recruitment, but we've been meeting regularly, and the latest meeting was this morning when I had confirmation we do have the numbers to staff all of our wards optimally. So we're there essentially from a staffing point of view.
Thanks very much. Is there any more questions from members of the committee? No. Thanks for that. Having taken into account the information provided to the committee over the series of meetings, including the consultation methodology, I formally move that the Joint Committee is satisfied that the proposals in the future model of hyper-acute stroke services are in the interest of the health services of the